We have already formed a quorum. It's the appointed time. I now call the meeting to order. First of all, I'd like to welcome you all to the meeting. Item 1, information papers issued since the last meeting. So, since the last regular meeting held on the 25th of February, the Secretariat has already set out the information in the paper. Items for discussion at the next meeting, that's item 2 on the agenda. So paper number, we have a list of outstanding items for discussion. The administration is proposing to discuss this first report on the work of the Competition Commission. That's item 1 on the list of outstanding items. And number 2, that's implementation of the trade descriptions Unfair Trade Practices Amendment Ordinance 2012. That's item 2 on the list. 3, proposed amendments to the pilotage ordinance and its subsidiary legislation. That's item 3 on the list. So do members agree that we should discuss these 3 items? The next regular meeting of the panel will be held on the 27th of June 2022. It's a Monday at 10:45. But since we have 3 items for discussion next time, we may not have enough time to discuss all of them, and if members do not object, then the Secretariat is proposing to have it started 15 minutes earlier. So in other words, it's going to start at 10:30 so that we can have enough time. And on the report on the work of the Competition Commission, I'd like to declare interest because I'm a member of the Competition Commission, and therefore I will not be chairing the discussion on this item, and instead I'll be asking the Deputy Chairman, Mr. Kenneth Wong, to chair the discussion on my behalf. Next item, update on the development of the 3-1-way system at the Hong Kong International Airport. So the team from the administration and the airport authority is joining us. So I'd like to invite members to declare interest before you speak, if there is any. Welcome to the administration and the representatives from the airport authority for joining our meeting. So while the representatives are speaking, I'd like to remind them that they not be covered by the electrical pass and privileges ordinance, so that the safeguards and the exemptions do not apply to them. So now I'd like to invite Mr. Leung to brief us. So he's the executive director of the Third Runway. Thank you, Chairman. Under the 14th five-year plan and also the GPA outline framework, we need to support them, and therefore under those circumstances we have decided to build the Third Runway in order to enhance our competitiveness. Because of the outbreak of the fifth wave of the epidemic, the runway project has also been affected, for example, in terms of logistics and also material supply and so on. There have been some impacts, but then we have already put in place appropriate measures. For example, contractors would be allowing us early access to work areas, and also there are also deployment of extra resources to extend working hours and so on. As a result of those measures, we have been able to work on schedule, and it's going to be commissioned in this year, and the relevant tests and inspection tests are ready, and we're making preparation for the 3RS commissioning. And with the commissioning of the 3RS, the existing runway will be closed for 2 years so that that can be reconfigured before recommissioning. And we will also be pressing ahead with other works, and the target is that the entire 3RS project can be completed and commissioned by 2024. I'll be deferring to my colleagues to brief you on the latest position. As to the cost for the construction of the 3RS, according to money of the day prices, is about 14.1 billion Hong Kong dollars, and as of end of May, we have already set aside $98.5 billion, and that's basically under control. And also we have also distributed or issued multi-stage institutional bonds and so on, and therefore it's very much okay. But then because of the current situation, after very careful consideration, we have updated the financial arrangements for the 3RS in March this year. We will also be giving you more details later. So I'll be deferring to Mr. Leung Keng Yin, Mr. Tommy Leung, Executive Director of the Third Runway, and also Mr. Julian Lee, Executive Director for the Financial Division, to brief you on the details. And then afterwards, we'll be happy to take members' questions. Thank you. Over to you, Tommy. Good morning, members and Chairman. First of all, I'll be refreshing members on the key features of the 3RS. It's not just about building the third runway, because we have to build an artificial, we have to refill land for the runway. We also need to have the terminal, we also have to have Terminal 3 and also Terminal 2, and also the relevant APM, automated people mover, and also the BHS, the baggage handling system. And also we're going to have a new airport support infrastructure right next to the central runway. As you can see from this picture, since 2016, when we started the reclamation works, this picture shows the reclamation works, and after about 4 years of works, we have basically completed the reclamation. And on the runway, you can see the taxiway, the runway, and also all the facilities. We can also do the flight check and so on. As to the actual works, we are nearing completion, and the targets are twofold. First, in 2022, we're going to complete the construction, and then in 2024, we're going to complete the entire 3RS system. So the construction work will be completed by 2024. As you can see from the eastern end and also from the western end, you can see the taxiway. You can also see what needs to be in place in 2022 for the commissioning of the third runway. So all the infrastructure is nearing completion. And from this PowerPoint, you can see that the taxiway will have to be connected to the existing dual runway system is also nearing completion. To tie in with what we're going to do for the commissioning of the third runway, there are a number of facilities, including airport authority facilities and also government facilities. As you can see here in the picture, you can see all the relevant, for example, the temporary control tower, and also power plant, and also the fire service station, and so on. They are already built, and they'll be handing over to the relevant departments, including government departments, so that they can gain access, and they can also make preparation for the commissioning of those facilities. Other than the commissioning of the third runway this year, at the same time, for what we need to do by 2024, they have also not been suspended at all. So for example, for the T2 concourse, the piling works have started in full steam. And also for the APM, and also the BHS, and also the pedestrian subway, we are also starting with extensive excavation works. And then for the existing T2 concourse or terminal, there will also be an expansion project. As you can see, we are working full steam on it. So by 2024, we aim to complete the entire project in time, on schedule. You can also see one of the projects would be under the existing AEL, the Airport Express line. The existing APM and also the BHS will have to be equipped with a tunnel. We have started with the preparation, and we have also very carefully introduced some delicate works process in order to ensure that the AEL will not be affected in any way. So that summarizes what we've been doing. That is, this year, 2022, we're going to commission the third runway. At the same time, the existing northern runway, that is the future center runway, will be closed for reconfiguration in order to tie in with the commissioning of the entire three one-way systems in 2024. Other than works, in terms of marine ecology and fishery enhancement, we have done two things. First, we have set up the marine ecology enhancement fund. The other one is a fisheries enhancement fund. We have spent over $30 million and $25 million respectively with the relevant trades. We have done many studies and researches, including Chinese white dolphins and also barrier artificial reef, and also the nurturing or breeding of pearls and so on. So we will continue with those projects so that we will also be rolling out new projects in the future. In terms of what is required on us by law, we have also done something extra in order to further enhance the marine ecology. We have also engaged experts to do some extra studies, including clusters of shellfish reefs and also artificial reef units and so on. Within the works area, we have already done a one-year project and testing to assess these two types of artificial reef units and also the clusters of shellfish reefs to see whether or not they'd be able to enhance the ecological value or habitat of the marine or waters are there. If they are found to be successful, we will be deploying extensively these units in order to enhance our marine ecology in the future. Here we have a video clip to share with you. That is in April this year, 2022, we have done a flight check. And that's the arrangement. Well, we can't hear the sound input, but then I can also do some voiceover here. Chairman, my apologies. Just now there was some technical hiccups. In brief, we completed that test in April this year. On that very same day, through the International Aviation Association, we have already issued this notice so that in 60 days, we are ready for commissioning the third runway. So that's all for my presentation. Okay, next, Mr. Julian Lee. Thank you, Chairman. If you look at the traffic load and also the financial performance of the airport authority, we have been under the impact of the fifth wave of the epidemic. If you look at the passenger volume and also the cargo volume, you can see that passenger volume is still very much lower than that for 2019. Well, on the left-hand side, you can see the passenger turnover. And then in April, we announced the 21-22 12 months traffic volume. And you can see that for passenger turnover, it's up from last year, up to 1.4 million passenger trips. But then it's just 2% of what it used to be in 2019. And then for cargo turnover, it's very strong. In 2021, in terms of cargo turnover, it went up by some 7% and reaching some 4.9 million tons. And then the two put together, in terms of flight takeoffs, that went up by some 13%, reaching 1.45 million takeoffs. And our financial performance has also been affected. Very often when we do our financial estimates, we would be looking at the cash flows.
Revenue has been drastically reduced. The AA has already adopted many cost-saving measures to improve the situation. On the left-hand corner, you'll find the EBITDA number. That is earnings before interest, taxation, and depreciation. Just now, we saw the chart for our cash flow position. We lost $180 odd million. So obviously, I think we are sort of breaking even. In terms of capital expenditure for the third runway system, overall we had a budget of $140 billion. By the end of September, we have spent about 53% of the budget. So most of the such expenses have already been incurred. Since the revenue has drastically dropped because of the COVID, the operational cash flow position has shrunk because of the drop in traffic. So we would need to rely on loans. Regarding the funding arrangements for the third runway, the AA is responsible entirely for the budget. We are relying on three sources of income, that is the external loans, the airport construction fee, and also our surplus. We have a rating of AA plus. So overall, while the epidemic poses a serious problem, but overall, the rating organization is still very optimistic about the prospect of the AA. On the 31st of March 2022, our total debt is $73 billion. According to the latest financial arrangement, total debt will go up to from $889 billion to $110 billion. Together with the earlier year, we issued $1.5 billion of U.S. Sustainable capital equity. So total, it's $123 billion Hong Kong dollars. Our financial consultant had actually worked out a worst case scenario. With assuming the highest gearing ratio, so it is still less than the $140 billion. I think at the time the assessment was that even in the worst case scenario, we would still be able to come up with a win-win financial arrangement. Of course, there's still a lot of uncertainty because of the COVID epidemic. And there still be challenges ahead in terms of our financing. Last year, we had a relatively large funding exercise. On the 12th of January this year, we had successfully issued a $4 billion bonds, which includes a 5-year green bond, $1 billion, and also a $1.2 billion 10-year U.S. bond, and a 30-year bond, $1 billion, and a $600 million 40-year bonds. For the four tranches of bonds, average interest rate was 2.73%. According to the latest sustainable financial development, we hope that the AA will continue to develop Hong Kong into a green and sustainable financial hub and showcase the Hong Kong IA's commitment to be the world, one of the world's greenest airports. For the four tranches of bonds, there are 200, professional investors from Europe and Asia, including asset management funds and so on. For most of the green bond was the most popular. All of the bonds are oversubscribed. For the four tranches, we had a total subscription of 112 billion. And we were able to issue it at a lower price than what we indicated in the guideline earlier. Through the issuance of bonds this time, we have been able to raise the amount of capital we require for the year. That is up to the end of March 2023. I think the bond issue I mentioned just now is the first green bond ever issued by the Hong Kong Airport Authority. It's also the first green bond issued by the aviation industry in Hong Kong. For the green bond has been most popular among the green investors. 59% have been allocated to these green investors. The issuance, it was the largest US denominated bonds ever issued by an issuer in Hong Kong. And also, it is also the one of the US denominated bonds with the longest tenure. Although the aviation industry is still affected by the epidemic, but we still have very good response, which shows that the investors have remained optimistic about the prospect of Hong Kong. For 2022-2023, we need to prepare to work out our capital requirement for 2023-2024. We still have $15 billion Hong Kong's Hong Kong AA debt, which will be disposed of by private placement. And also there will be, we also have a standby credit of $17.5 billion. Depending on the state of the epidemic and the recovery of the avian industry, and when air traffic improves, we will consider to issue another 5 billion Hong Kong denominated, Hong Kong dollar denominated retail bonds. In June 2020, we signed a 5-year standby revolving credit with banks amounting to $15 billion. So far we have not yet actually drawn on that amount, so we will be able to draw on the standby credit. Overall speaking, for our financing plan for the next 3 years, basically we'll be mostly relying on issuing bonds and green. We will also be issuing more green bonds. Although we are all entering the stage of interest rate hikes, but most of our projects have already been completed, so our overall interest expenditure should be able to remain stay at what the financial consultant predicted. Of course, globally the epidemic is posing creating a lot of uncertainties, especially because of the COVID variant. We'll continue to monitor the impact of COVID and adjust our plans accordingly. It's now time for questions. Because of the time constraint, we're scheduled to finish this item by 12, so I'll need to exercise tight management, and I propose that each member be given 4 minutes. Mr. Sunny Tan, first of all, I'd like to declare that my family owns an air cargo freight company. Regarding the development of the third runway and the latest state of the pandemic, I'd like to ask questions regarding the state of the cargo freight situation. A joint venture of Alibaba, they will start operation in 2023. Given the state of the pandemic, I think the business on e-com has drastically gone up, and internet transactions would also generate more, demand for, air freight. So I'd like to know whether the AAA can give me an update or in that regard. Now, who would like to take that question? I'm Vivian Jiang from the Airport Authority. Regarding cargo trade,
cargo are still very strong. Last year, still 5 million tons of cargo. We are still number one in the world. And in fact, a lot of resource this year have been pulling to cargo. You will see that a lot of hiring, including labor and equipment, all gear up for more cargo to facilitate cargo flow. And you, your question regarding to Alibaba's operation, yes, the construction is going very well. And the Alibaba site, I mean the new site at the airport, will be operating soon. I believe that this sector is still very strong, and resource is also very quite enough to support the growth. Okay,
thank you.
A follow-up.
How does the new runways, the overall construction, the timetable getting all the way to 2024 versus the some of these new logistics hub getting it done by 2023, and the latest development on the internet, e-commerce, business, everything, how does that matching up? Do we anticipate any problem, or everything goes very smoothly?
Okay, for the all right. I will have our financial.
I may supplement. Overall speaking, I think the cargo throughput at the airport, I think as the passenger traffic has dropped a lot, I think we need to wait for a few more years, depending on the recovery of the. I think it will take some time for us to go back to the pre-COVID situation. Overall, there's no problem with our capacity. Even when we operated two runways previously, we didn't encounter any problems. In the midst of the pandemic, we have worked very hard on the cargo side because that helped our revenue. Other than Alibaba, we've also, through Hong Kong Post, worked with China Mail. In terms of logistics, we have made a lot of efforts, including the integrated, mail and so on. And we also want to maintain our edge in terms of the air cargo business. I'll read out the order for members to speak. We are going to have Mr. Stephen Ho, followed by Mr. YIU Pak-leung, Chen Shu-hong, Andrew Lam, with Dr. Wendy Hong, Robert Lee, Yim Kong, Tan Yu-hang, Holden Chow, and Jeffrey Lam. Stephen Lo, first of all, I'd like to commend the AA for exercising such excellent, financial control, and there have been no major hiccups, even though there has been a shortfall of the marine sand. I also like to say that when they built the second runway, they had the relationship with the fishing industry was very bad. But I think the situation has since improved. They've also set up a fisherman liaison group. So any problems encountered during the construction period, for example, for some of the, you know, shark nets, you know, sometimes fishermen would actually would run into these nets. But also there were no lamps on the buoys, and through liaison with the AA, I think we were able to reduce the number of accidents at sea.
Initially, one might have thought that for fishermen, all they wanted would be money, but that's not true. And therefore, I think we have done a remarkable job. And of course, there are still some problems. So I'd like to say this to Mr. So, Dr. Raymond So. That is in terms of the design of the 3RS and also the marine walks and so on. Well, actually, there's a marine park. I'd like to say this. These would also deal a double blow to the fishermen because they haven't really accepted that proposal for the construction of the marine park, and therefore this is really annoying them. And also for the marine traffic, that would also have a negative effect because for Sha Chau and Long Ku Chau, well, basically there's very little space in between. And also, if you're not able to see, actually the depth of water would be about 5-6 meters. But then once they narrow the strip for the marine park and so on, so there would just be a distance of about 30-40 meters. So for the fishing vessels, they would also need the water depth to be about 5-6 meters. And therefore, there is a high risk of fishing vessels are capsizing, and therefore, under the relevant legislation, I think the navigation channel would not be somewhere where you can do any marine digging or excavation or dredging. So you will have to be very careful about this. What's your response, Dr. So? So that for fishermen and also for the users of that navigation channel, how can you reassure them that there will be no risk of vessels capsizing there? Yes, Dr. So. Yes, thank you for the question raised by Mr. Stephen Ho and his comments. Well, all along, when we press ahead with the 3RS project, we've been very concerned about the environmental impact. That's the reason why in our EIA, we said that we'd be setting up this marine park. And of course, we will have to ensure that it's in full compliance with the relevant legislation. What about the navigation channel? Yes, Mr. Ho, you referred to the navigation channels. Well, they might be narrowed. But then from the navigation perspective, yes, we need to communicate more with the fishing industry so that they will be updated on the latest developments. On the other hand, we also need to monitor closely the operational issues. There might be concerns that we need to address. If the water is too shallow, that's not something that can be resolved. Because for the 2,400 hectares of marine park, they will have to make a lot of go for a very convoluted navigation route before they can bypass that. Yes, we are aware of the concerns of the fishermen. We would be liaising closely with the fishermen to understand their needs, to see what we can do to help them. Okay, that will have to be taken up later. Yes, they will have to give us something in writing. Next, Mr. YIU Pak-leung, thank you, Chairman. I have to declare interest because my parent company has also got some projects or facilities in the airport. I'm pleased to hear from the airport authority that the third runway system will be completed on schedule and within budget. Well, still, I have several concerns that I'd like to raise here. As you know, for the travel industry, we fully supported the third runway project and we look forward to the commissioning of it. But then, unfortunately, we are hit by the epidemic, including the airport authority, and therefore the pressure has been tremendous. So with the commissioning of the third runway. So for the number of flights per hour, we're talking about 102 per hour. And also in terms of passenger turnover, it can be over 100 million passenger trips per year. So how can we be sure about maintaining our status as an international center for aviation? And if we were to be sure about the development of our aviation industry, does the airport authority have any plans for that while the epidemic is becoming or is easing, so that everything is now under control? How can we once again reinvigorate the industry? We are unique in the sense that our geographical location is very unique, and we also have our own aviation space and rights, and we are at the same time a very efficient international airport. Those are our advantages. But then in terms of our competitiveness, and also in terms of our fee charging mechanism, is there any room for a further review? Yes, for the airport construction fee, we started with that in 2016. For how long are we going to charge our passengers and users of the airport? And also, as the administration announced from the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge, if people cross the boundary by land, then they'll have the cross boundary tax waived. So, what about the airport authority? Do you have any plans to make adjustments to the fees that you impose on passengers and cargo? Well, I'll make a brief response, and then I'll ask my colleagues from the airport authority to supplement. In fact, under the 14 five-year plan, Hong Kong has been fully reassured that we will continue to be the international aviation hub. We will continue to plan for that. Other than increasing passenger turnover, we would also be increasing our capacity for cargo transition and so on. Well, given Hong Kong's status, we'll be able to contribute to our country. And we believe that in the long run, when the epidemic eases off, in terms of both cargo and passenger turnover, both will grow. And the airport authority is also fully confident in the future of our aviation industry. And we will also be making visionary planning in order to tie in with that policy. I'll defer to the colleagues from the airport authority to give us all the details. Vivian?
Our hub status, we have done quite a lot of preparation until the policy changed, open border policy changed, and we are ready to gear up to with the entire industry to welcome the passenger coming back. Now, to sustain our hub status, of course, four elements very important: government's policy, and then the local economy, and airline, local-based airline status, and also airport's readiness. So all four we have prepared for it. And like the Bureau just mentioned, that once the passenger come back, we also have a lot of other activity to ensure that we can capture the market and to welcome the passenger back. Your question regarding the construction fee, I'll have our financial director to answer that.
機場建設費呢就...
Well, for the airport construction fee, well, that's one of the financing methods for the construction of the third runway. Well, during the past 2 years, because of the construction of the third runway, the financial position has dealt a very severe blow to us because of the epidemic. And therefore, looking forward, we have to do something about it. But then on the basis of the current position, we will have to charge it until 2033-34. We expect to be able to pay up all the debts in relation to the third runway project. And then according to our benchmark forecast, we should be able to suspend or to cancel the fee altogether. We have 9 more members who would like to speak, and therefore I'll have to draw a line there. Next, Mr. Chen Xiu-hong. Thank you, Chairman. Well, under the impact of the fifth wave of the epidemic, the Airport Authority is still maintaining a schedule of commissioning the third runway within this year. And they've actually done the flight check last month. And in terms of financial management, they have done a remarkable job. And therefore, I'd like to recognize their performance because we've been able to ensure labor safety and so on, and those have been affected by the epidemic, and cost control is another issue, and therefore the Airport Authority must have done a very good job in these areas. I'd like them to make sure that we'd be able to complete everything by 2024. I have two issues concerning the operation that I'd like to raise with them. According to the paper, with the commissioning of the third runway, the center runway will be closed for 2 years for reconfiguration. And then they'll be using the temporary dual runway system, and that would continue for a while. According to my experience, the biggest problem would be in terms of the change in the operational system. When it comes to normal operation, when it's transitioned to the temporary system, and then they would also have to be reverted back to the normal system. So how can you make sure that, how can you be sure that it'll be safe and reliable? And also, what about the transitional work? Well, in the paper, you said that you'd be updating the stakeholders' menu and so on. So have you looked at any major incidents? So have you updated the contingency plan and also the relevant drills in order to ensure that everything will be a seamless transition? Thank you, Mr. Chen. In the coming 2 years, with the completion of the third runway, the existing center runway will be closed. So we have already done a number of drills, and we have already worked with all the stakeholders. We have organized a number of workshops to communicate with them. And we have also come up with a number of contingency plans, and there'll be another major drill so that for the emergency teams and also the rescue teams and also the CAD would also be fully involved so that all the work arrangements and operational arrangements will have to be 100% safe. And also, in terms of our contingency plan, we have also looked at different scenarios. And so rest assured, we will be able to make sure that the temporary arrangements will be safe and reliable. Well, this is what I'm most concerned about. So if you do have information that you can provide to us, please do so after the meeting. Some members have also talked about the ACF, the airport construction fee. So I'm concerned that in your estimates, in your budget, well, you've been charging that now, and then once the third runway and the relevant debts have been fully repaid, then you'd be lifting that ACF. So according to your forecast and projection, in terms of the scenario analysis, for example, in terms of passenger load and also cargo load and so on, so for how many years would you need to charge that ACF, and in how many years will you be able to break even? Does it take 10 years or longer? So I'd like to know the rough estimate. Who is to answer the question? Julian? Yes. I share the sentiments of our members, and I'm very concerned about this. And we have done many forecasts and projections. Overall speaking, the aviation industry thinks that it would take at least 3-4 years before we can be back to the pre-epidemic situation. So we do have some loss, but then it's not a very major loss. So we expect that if we were to return to the pre-COVID situation, in terms of EBITDA, that's very healthy. And we believe that we don't have to wait for 3 years before we get back to normal. I think in 2 years, our net profit should be okay. But then overall speaking, if you'd like to see a rebound, to what extent will it be very strong? It depends on the anti-epidemic measures. So it's hard to project right now. But then we do have a base case. for example, this year, we expect that there would be some form of recovery, and that's the basis for our projection. But then if the situation gets worse, then of course we will have to make some fine-tuning. Thank you.
Mr. Lam Siu-Long, thank you. In terms of hardware, the timetable, and the control of the budget, I have to commend the AA for doing a good job. Now, I understand that you still have two more years before the third runway will be fully commissioned. During the past, there have been staff turnover at different levels. So I'd like to know, for the next 2 years and until the third runway is fully commissioned, in terms of manpower resources, what is your estimate? Do you envisage there will be challenges? Secondly, I'd like to ask the Bureau this question. The third runway is now successfully completed. In the Greater Bay Area, I mean, what is the prospect of your discussion with the airport authorities in the Greater Bay Area? Secretary? I'll ask the AA to answer the first question regarding the demographic projection. As I said, in the 14th five-year plan and the planning framework for the GBA, Hong Kong has been positioned as an international aviation hub. So we'll maintain close liaison with the airports in the GBA, including the Zhuhai Airport. And we will also closely liaise with the national, aviation ministry to see how we can optimize the efficiency of the third runway. It is our estimate that with the commissioning of the third runway, it will bring many opportunities and also help Hong Kong to contribute to the development of our country. AA?
Readiness. I would like to answer on the Founder 3 area. One is that currently, actually, we have enough resource to cater for the current operation. And the resource for 2024 or 2025, that if according to IATA, that 3 or 4 years later, the flight will resume to pre-pandemic. So that's about passenger flow is about 70 million to 75 million. And that we will need about the same resource as 2019 or 2018. Okay, so we are gearing up for that kind of resource. And currently we have enough. So three areas to prepare for that. One is that in the past two, three years, we have been very actively putting investment on automation. So we want to make sure that a lot of automation is there to make the airport even more efficient. And secondly, that we have established an academy to ensure that training is there so we can recruit more people and get them ready. The third is that according to the flight resumption, and we're working very closely with our industry to resume the recruitment step by step. So right now we have enough. And when we see more flight coming in, there will be recruitment and editing resource with training with automation. Okay, thank you.
I'd
like to follow up and ask the Secretary this question. Regarding your liaison with the Zhuhai Airport, when will we be able to hear some positive news? I think the work is ongoing. If there's any further progress, we will inform members, in a timely manner. Dr. Hong, Chairman, first of all, I'd like to declare my interest. My company has participated in the construction of the airport. I'd like to echo Mr. Stephen Ho's commendation of the AA and their cooperation with the fishing industry. Earlier, I raised the issue regarding the pearl culture palm. The Pearl River Delta, I think Shenzhen used to be, a place where the pearl culture industry existed already. Hong Kong is the largest pearl trading center in the world. So there is room for the development of the pearl culture industry, and I'm glad that they continue to get the support of the AA. I have many questions. I'm afraid I may not be able to exhaust all of them. In the policy address this year, it was suggested that Hong Kong should change from a city airport to become an airport city. It can also help diversify the industry, the economy. Airport plays a very important role, so I hope that the Bureau and the AA can have a more, strategic, perspective to develop Hong Kong into an airport city. Earlier, I have visited the Shenzhen and Guangzhou airport. Honestly, they told me that the Hong Kong airport, whether it's international passenger traffic or cargo traffic, 30% of the cargoes and passengers come from the Pearl River Delta. And they think that in future, they would like to get back such passenger and cargo traffic, which they believe should be yours. Well, healthy competition is a good thing. So in future, how do we cope with competition for the international flights? In May this year, Shenzhen will have a pilot area for the testing of the So what is the progress regarding the control of the airspace in Hong Kong and Shenzhen? Well, I think we're talking about the third runway today, and Dr. Wen is asking questions which involve a much broader perspective. Secretary, would you like to answer the question? Well, Dr. Hong asked many questions regarding the development of the PRD. As I said earlier, we are now actively liaising and studying with the Macau and the National Aviation Authorities regarding, the prospect of the air aviation industry and how to ensure that the third runway will actually, be able to operate at maximum efficiency. So the AA at the moment has really done a lot of work in that area. As for cooperation among airports, I think the AA has made a lot of effort in the GBA at different ports. We are offering various services which actually has enhanced the competitiveness of our airport. The third runway will be fully commissioned in 2024, and that can help greatly expand our passenger and cargo traffic, so that we'll be able to actually leverage on the opportunities brought by the development of the Greater Bay Area. Dr. Lee Wai Wang. Chairman, I actually work in the financial industry, so I'd like to declare my interest. As a member of the financial industry, I'm very concerned about the development of the financial industry, and our country has clearly positioned Hong Kong as an aviation center. For the retail bonds issued by the AA, the issue was cancelled in February this year. I understand that the AA, regarding the organizational bans, the institutional bans, they have launched successful issues. I understand that from the cost of financing, the AA may not need to spend a lot of effort on retail finance, but the AA, which is wholly owned by the government, being a statutory organization, will you further promote the issue of retail bonds so that to help the public better understand the work of the AA? Furthermore, promoting the sale of retail bonds will enable people from different sectors to participate in the bond issuing industry. And the public can also better understand how the bonds operate. It can also satisfy the investors' need for these fixed income investments. Of course, you will consider the issuance of such bonds, bearing in mind the state of the epidemic. But will you give us further details and ensure that in future the issue of issuance of retail bonds will not be cancelled? Thank you. Actually, the retail bonds, we really want to issue those those retail bonds. But as you know, whenever we issue any financial, you know, instruments, we have to consider the state of the market, especially for the AA. I think we are highly dependent on how the tourism industry recover. We already have made the preparation. Now, if the epidemic situation improves, we were just about to issue those bonds, but it just happened that we were hit by the new wave of the epidemic. We really wanted to issue those retail bonds, and I agree with the member that the issuance of retail bonds can help the general public and investors to understand the construction of the third runway. So we have to look at the state of the epidemic, and we are closely monitoring the situation, and we will come up with, you know, timely announcements in due course. Mr. Yim Kong, Chairman, I'd like to declare, first of all, that the organization represent is the second largest shareholder of the company. Now, Hong Kong is an important aviation center. Now, the third runway is a huge investment. We hope that after its commissioning, it will be able to actually, you know, expand its business. I think our cargo trade is the freight volume is the highest in the world. And for after the completion of the third runway, we hope it will go up to 1,000 metric tons. How can we, so it will help to, you know, boost the passenger and cargo traffic. I'm concerned about how we can, you know, cooperate with our counterparts in the mainland. Actually, our pier at the airport is already connected to Shekau. So my question is, in the budget this year, it was mentioned that Dongguan has set up a logistics park for the airport. So what about also in terms of passenger traffic, in order to attract more visitors from the mainland to come to Hong Kong? It was once explored that we should have implement co-location at the airport of Hong Kong. Will that continue? To answer Mr. Yim's second question regarding co-location, I'll take that question and I'll ask the AA to answer the question regarding the Dongguan Logistics Park. In my answer to Dr. Hong's question, we've done a lot of work in terms of how we may attract more passenger traffic. We really hope to be able to further, you know, enhance the connection between the Hong Kong AA at airport with the airports in the mainland, so that cross-border visitors can have a seamless, you know, cross-border experience. So we will continue to explore with the AA as to how we can effectively improve our custom clearings, process. With that, I'll ask the AA to answer the question regarding the logistics park and the
yep. continual flow into Hong Kong and to be still as the most important cargo hub in the world. That we actually have many different projects to ensure the source of the cargo coming to Hong Kong. You mentioned about the project with Dongguan. Actually, when the progress quite well, we have conducted a trial several times to ensure that the flow works, and also the process to be implement in the Dongguan side will work smoothly, and the trial went well. And this year, we're going to continue to do this trial to ensure that all parties involved understand the process and to make sure that when we implement formally, everything will go well too. So we don't have the exact time yet, but I would just like to say that the progress is going smoothly. Okay.
Okay. How we can
next, Dr. Tan Yue Heng. Thank you, Chairman. And thank you to the Airport Authorities, our colleagues. First of all, I'd like to commend the bond issued by the Airport Authority in January this year. It has been very successful. So it's the largest scale and also the longest dated. Can you speak closer to the mic, please, Mr. Tan, I was just commending the issuance of the bond by the Airport Authority earlier this year. Despite the epidemic, there's been a reduction in terms of the operational profits and the debt scale has also gone up. So that has changed the liquidity position of the Airport Authority. So we'll be increasing external funding by some 20 billion Hong Kong dollars. So that's roughly what they have done. But in terms of the operational proceeds and also the airport construction fee and also external fundraising, well, because of the epidemic, the ratio between the three will have to be changed. So what's the ratio like now? And also, we are also undergoing this interest hike cycle. And that would also affect our financial position and funding costs. A total of 12.3 billion Hong Kong dollars will have to be raised according to your estimate. But what about the interest hike? Would that affect our funding plan? Mr. Lee, thank you for the question. Well, indeed, with regard to our funding approach, given the reduction in the operational profit and the funding gap is becoming wider now. But then as you asked, for the funding ceiling, that would need about 12.3 billion Hong Kong dollars. But then for the total investment, it's $14 billion, and therefore, indeed, the gap has widened. But then what's fortunate is that earlier on, during the past couple of years, when we raise funds, we completed most of those lendings while the interest rate was still quite low, and therefore, we've been able to lock that interest rate. And as you might be aware, we have also made some further reviews. Because for the interest, for the bonds, it's a long-term investment. And therefore, in terms of the tenure, that's also something to be considered very carefully. So we have adopted the long-dated tenure approach. So the interest rate has been estimated at a very conservative rate at around 5%. And we managed to lock the interest rate at around 2%. Looking forward, while the interest rate is on the upward trend, of course, that would have an impact on us. But then as most of our funds have been locked at a lower interest rate, and therefore that's something pretty fortunate, and therefore you don't have to be over worried about that. Next, Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chairman. Well, for the third runway project, we can see that the financial management and also despite the epidemic, in terms of the spending control, they have done a remarkable job. And therefore, in the briefing, we can see that they have put in a lot of efforts in achieving that. What I'd like to know is the future cargo or freight cargo freight estimates. Yes, for passenger turnover, I understand that there's still a lot of uncertainty and it has been affected by the epidemic. But then for cargo, looking at the past few years, it's been about 5 million tons per year. And this year, the latest position is about 4.9 million. So it's quite stable. But then many years ago, when the administration did some estimates for the purpose of constructing the third runway, it's estimated that by 2030, when the third runway has been commissioned, they'd be able to achieve a target of some 9 million tons per year. And of course, you have upped that to some 10 million tons a year. Earlier on, you said that by 2030, you should be able to create 140,000 jobs and about 200,000 indirect jobs. But then given the epidemic, as we said just now, if we were to go back to the pre-epidemic days, it would take several years, at least by 2025, before we'd be able to go back to the pre-epidemic situation. But then for cargo, have you done any estimate, given the current situation with the commissioning of the third runway in the next few years, in terms of the cargo turnover, to what extent would it grow? And also, what about the jobs that can be created? So for cargo freight, will you be able to tell us exactly how many jobs can be created? Because that would also be very important to our economic situation. So that's a very important indicator too. So can you tell us, Airport Authority? Well, let me try and answer that question. As I said, for cargo, is something that we are very concerned about because for passenger traffic, we simply cannot see any rise in the short term. And then, in fact, 4.9 million tons is already quite high a figure because 4.9 million, we are already the top. Very rarely can we see both passenger and cargo freight doing very well. We are one of the few that has been able to do so well. And therefore, we have put in a lot of efforts in order to do that. But then there are some barriers to overcome. For example, as I said, the Pearl River Delta, well, to what extent are they able to send out cargo? Because the epidemic situation in the Pearl River Delta would also affect us. And there are things that are beyond our control. And also, something has to do with the GDP of the Greater Bay Area. We have done some estimates, but then we have been climbing steadily. So we have come up with these forecasts, and if things go well, then of course that would be like what we had expected. But then we cannot expect something to happen overnight. But then, as I said, Alibaba and so on, they've also invested in us, and also midstream, we have also done something. And in Dongguan, we have also got the logistics park. That's also a new attempt on our part. Because cargo would also come from there. And if we are able to use this new mode of operation, would that improve the situation? But then, as some members have said, other airports are also competing with us. So we have been in competition with those nearby airports as well. And therefore, we have to have some breakthroughs. We've been investing in these areas so that we can do an even better job. Next, Stephen Ho asking in the second round. Thank you for allowing me to ask in the second round because I haven't finished with my first round yet. Yes, I've been commending the Airport Authority, but then I also have some criticisms. For example, on the Environmental Fund and also the Fisheries Enhancement Fund, we do have some qualms about this because for the fishermen groups, they are very scattered. And therefore, you're actually generating some interest and that's used for them. That's very small. So you introduced the $50 million fund. Well, initially, that was very good. But then the interest aggregated, the interest so aggregated would be very small. And therefore, in due course, you would also have to make up for the inadequacy because environmental protection and the fisheries are not in conflict at all. In fact, they can complement one another. And therefore, fishermen would also need to be protected. So you don't have to answer that question. Next is about water death. Well, I wrote to the chairman, and chairman felt that I'd better ask it myself, because from the reply that I got from them, apparently the gentleman from the airport authority was not too sure about this. In fact, we have reflected that on many occasions. In fact, water death has a lot to do with their livelihood. And the airport authority has actually spent several million dollars to do some water investigation or water death survey. I have to commend them for their efforts, but then the communication mechanism might not have been able to deal with the feedback that you collected. For example, for the third runway, I think for members of the public and lawmakers, even if you know that water death is not adequate, nothing can be done about it. So you have to have a contingency plan to deal with this very imminent problem. So I think you're adopting this top-down approach when it comes to communication, and that's problematic. And therefore, when you would need to do a water depth survey in and around the third runway, and also for the marine park, 2,400 hectares. So you would affect the speed of the vessel, and there are areas that would be closed off for fishing vessels and so on. So what would be changed about the navigation route, and also how much more fuel do they have to use? And then you will have to come up with a contingency plan under those scenarios, because airport infrastructure is very important. Third runway is very important, but then you'd be exploiting the fishermen's livelihood. They would be spending more than $1,000 in fuel every day if they had to make a detour. So you will have to deal with that. You will have to come up with a contingency plan to help these fishing vessels and also non-fishing vessels, so that they'd be able to use more energy-saving fuel, for example, solar power. So you will have to deal with that. If you're not able to answer that question right now, give us a written reply. Thank you for your questions. I fully agree with you in the sense that we have to be very concerned about the fishing industry, and your efforts are remarkable. Well, navigation safety and so on would also be very important. I'll be giving you further details after the meeting. Well, that can be done in writing. Well, just one word. I think we have already brought that up a few years ago, and you're telling me today that you will have to go back and think about it. I can just take your word here. But then you will have to really come up with a package. Next, Chen Xiuhong, second round. You have pressed the button. No, I think it's something with the system. Okay, if there are no further questions from members, then I'd like to thank the representatives from the airport authority as well as our officials for attending the meeting for this item. Thank you. Okay, we are now on item 4, updates on marine legislation. Well, let's wait for the next team to join us. Okay, I welcome to the officials. Okay, for those members who would like to speak, please press the button to request to speak. And I'd also like to remind members that if you have any interest involved, please declare them before you speak. Okay, Ms. Christina Chong from the Transport and Housing Bureau, are you ready? Yes, thank you, Chairman, members. with regard to five legislative proposals to implement the latest amendments to the three conventions of United Nations. I would like to brief you. Well, Hong Kong has become an associate member of the International Maritime Organization, and therefore there is a need for us to enact legislation in order to implement the latest requirements under the three international conventions. That's our international obligation. As the IMO would from time to time review and update the relevant requirements under the conventions, and therefore our marine legislation would also have to be amended on a regular basis in order to update them. With regard to the five proposals that we present to members today, they are mainly to implement the three international conventions on the protection of the environment and also on the control of harmful substances and so on.
三項的立法建議均是針對國際海事組織 国际防止船舶造成污染工业，简称防污工业的技术性修订。防污工业的要求是透过商船防止及控制污染条例第413章下的各项附属法例实施。我们需要修订相关的条文。具体来讲，第一项建议是禁止船舶
For use as fuel of heavy fuel oil by ships, and also to reduce the impact of the emission of black carbon. And this will come in effect globally. So we need to amend the Merchants Prevention of Oil Pollution Cap 313, namely the oil pollution regulation, to implement a new requirement. The second suggestion is to the exemption of unmanned non-self-propelled barges from survey and certification requirements. The new requirement will come into effect globally on the 1st of November 2022, and we will amend CAP 413 and also the Merchant Shipping Prevention of Air Pollution. We amend that regulation. Third regulation is about the new requirement regarding certain greenhouse gases emissions. The new requirement will come into effect on November 1st, 2022, globally. We need to amend the air pollution regulation and to implement the amendment into our local legislation. The fourth proposal is the control of cyclobutane for use as a biocide in the anti-fouling system of ships. And that amendment will come into effect on January 1st, 2023 globally. For that, we will need to amend the Merchant Shipping Control of Anti-Fouling System of Ships. The last requirement is to reflect the regular revision of the IMD Dangerous Goods Code. The IMO from time to time will regulate the IMDG to update the technical and transportation requirements for existing materials. The newly amended regulation regarding the IMDG will come into effect on June 1st, 2022, and for that we need to amend our Merchant Shipping Safety Fire Prevention Ordinance covering boat ships which were and also we need to amend the merchant ships built on and after 25th of May 1980 but before September 1st, 1984. And also the Merchant Shipping Safety Fire Protection Ships on and after 1st September 1984, and also the general regulations, Merchant Ships Cap 548F. Depending on the progress of the legislative amendments, it is our proposal that in the first half of 2022, all these five legislative proposals will be submitted to LegCo for the negative vetting, so that the latest requirement of the IMO can be immediately implemented in Hong Kong. Chairman, I propose that we first invite the Marine Department to brief members on these legislative proposals by way of a PowerPoint presentation. After that, we'll be happy to take members' questions. Thank you, Permanent Secretary. Marine Department. Mr. Tang, you need to switch on your mic. Now, who is going to walk us through the PowerPoint? Mr. Liu. Thank you, Chairman. And members, the first legislative proposal is the prohibition on the use and carriage for use as fuel of heavy fuel oil by ships in the Arctic waters. In order to prevent the Arctic waters from being polluted, and also to minimize to protect the fragile marine department in the Arctic waters, the Annex 1 to MARPOL is now proposed. The purpose is to ban the use and carriage for use as fuel of heavy fuel oil by ships in the Arctic waters. The new amendments will come into force globally on November 1st, 2022. And for that, we are proposing to amend the Merchant Shipping Prevention of Oil Pollution Regulation. The second legislative proposal is the exemption of the UNSP barges from survey and certification requirements. Since there are no propelling machinery or other machinery using fuel, and it is also unmanned, and it will not be allowed to carry sewage or oil fuel, and hence it will not cause any oil pollution or polluting the environment through emission. And in order to minimize the administrative cost, the IMO is now proposing to amend Annex 1 and also Annex 4 and Annex 6 of MARPOL, which is in respect of air pollution, to waive certain requirements for survey and certification for unmanned self-propelled barges. The latest amendment, this latest amendment will come into force on November 1st, 2022. For that, we propose to amend CAP 413K and also the Merchant Shipping Prevention of Air Pollution Regulation 413, CAP 413B, to implement the new requirements in relation to the regulations regarding air pollution. The third legislative proposal is about the latest requirement regarding greenhouse gas emission. To implement the preliminary estimate for carbon emission and also the strategy regarding greenhouse emission, the MARPOL has amended Annex 6, which set out the requirements for preventing or controlling air pollution caused by ships. They are proposing two new measures. First of all, they have reduced the CII, the Carbon Intensity Index, to control the emission by ocean-going vessels in order to satisfy the target gas emission targets of the IMO. And the EEXI is based on the carbon emission of vessels. All relevant shipping vessel irrespective of the year they were built. After January 1st, 2023, all these vessels will need to be certified and obtain a certificate in terms of EEXI. For ships which cannot satisfy this target, they will have to come up with relevant measures, for example, to enhance their function, to limit the power output of the engine, and also to wind propelled or solar propelled, machinery and so on to satisfy the requirement. Secondly, the carbon intensity index, which actually is an indication of the fuel used, and every year we will need to measure the report the CII value of the vessel, and the authorized authorities will survey the ship and sign the certificate. Based on the CII value, the ships will be classified from class A to E. If a vessel should fall under class D for 3 consecutive years or into class E for 1 year, then they'll have to come up with a rectification plan in order to satisfy the surveying and certification requirements. All these two new requirements will come into effect on the 1st of November 2022. For that, we propose to amend the Merchant Shipping Prevention of Air Pollution Regulation CAP 413P. Mr. Yeo, I think many of these things we've already read in the paper, so you don't need to go into such details. Anything else? The fourth legislative proposal is the control on cybernetine for use as a biocide in the anti-fouling system on ships. Now, since these materials will actually add to the resistance and reduce the speed of the ship and also increase the fuel consumption, and also, well, the IMO now, regarding given the cybernetine as a biocide, will have damage will have an adverse impact on the marine environment. They have therefore amended the anti-fouling ships convention to ban the use of cybernetine as a biocide. The new requirement will come into effect on January 1st, 2023. To implement this latest requirement, we propose to amend the Merchant Shipping Control of Harmful Anti-Fouling System on Ships Regulation, CAP 413N. The fifth legislative proposal is a revision of the IMDG code. Different dangerous goods are categorized, and also there are requirements regarding the storage and labeling of different types of dangerous goods. The IMO, to keep in pace with the latest change, every 2 years there will be an amendment to these requirements. The major amendment this time is to amend the definition of dangerous goods and also the categorization of dangerous goods, and also introducing various standards, and also amending the requirements regarding the packaging and labeling of these dangerous goods. There are some major examples here. Four new categories: UN 1289, UN 1431, UN 3206, and 3274. in the list of dangerous goods, they have added, you know, four different types of medical waste. They are UN 0511, 0512, 0513, and 3549. For packaging of lithium battery, the packaging measurements have been amended. All these new requirements will come in effect on June 1st, 2022. For that, we propose to amend the emergent shipping, you know, fire prevention bracket regulation for ships built before May 25th, 1982, and also to amend the emergent shipping safety fire prevention equipment for ships made between May 25th, 1980.
And also merchant shipping safety fire protection ships built on or after the 1st of September 1984 regulations CAP 369Y and also CAP 548F, that is the merchant shipping local vessels general regulation. We have already consulted the Hong Kong Fleet Operation Advisory Committee and the Local Vessels Advisory Committee of the Marine Department. Members of those two committees supported the proposals. So, Chairman, I propose to listen to members' views on these legislative proposals. Thank you. Well, this is the floor will now open to members. Five members have pressed the button, so we will end the meeting by 12:45. Five minutes for each members, including both questions and answers. I'd like to remind members that this is a very technical proposal, and therefore, when you ask questions, please make sure that your questions are related to these technical amendments. So I'd like to draw your attention to that. First, Mr. Chen Pui-leung. Thank you, Chairman. I understand that the administration will have to implement the requirements of the IMO, and that's the reason why you have submitted the five legislative proposals. I'd like to ask the following questions. First, for the five legislative proposals, and their implementation to a certain extent that would also have some impact on our marine industry. So have you done any assessment with the commencement of these legislative proposals? Will that have any impact on us as an international maritime center? Next, concerning the operators in the industry, I can see that some of these will come into effect on the 1st of June, and the latest would be the end of this year when the rest will come into effect. So to our maritime industry, what's the impact? Do they have enough time to make preparation for the commencement of the new requirements? And also, have you provided any assistance to them? Thank you. Deputy Secretary. Thank you. With regard to consulting the trade, the Marine Department, as soon as is aware of the relevant amendments, it already contacted the trade. And we also consulted the relevant advisory committees, as Mr. Liu already briefed you. In fact, we have already consulted the Hong Kong Fleet Operation Advisory Committee, the High Speed Craft Consultative Committee, and also the Local Vessels Advisory Committee. So these committees are broadly representative of the trade. We asked them if they would have any difficulties and whether there would be some operational needs. They said that they would be in support of that because Hong Kong is a signatory to the IMO through China. So we do have the obligation to implement the requirements of the IMO, and they understand this very well. And therefore, they are in support of those, and they also understand the technical content of these amendments. According to our understanding from their feedback, well, concerning these amendments, they think it's okay, because that would not affect their operations. because all we are doing is to introduce these technical amendments. For example, for sibutrilin, they cannot be used as a biocide in the anti-fouling system of the ships. Well, when they apply for any permission from us, they would have enough time to make preparation for that. If they had been using this substance, that is the sibutrilin, then they can always use an alternative in the anti-fouling system of vessels. And therefore, we have talked to them, and they find it okay. And also, Hong Kong is an international maritime center. It's a shipping center. And we are also one of the four major register ports for vessels, and therefore we do have this international obligation to implement the requirements of the IMO for the purpose of protecting the environment. So that's all I'd like to say. Thank you. Next, Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Chairman. Well, internationally speaking, once these conventions are in place, whatever we try to do, we will not be able to influence them. That's a fact. And also, when it comes to legislative proposals and their consultation, all right, the administration said that they had already consulted the trade. Well, to what extent have they really done so? And what about the feedback given to them by the trade? Are we able to cover everybody? I dare not say so, because earlier on, for example, there were earlier proposals on major international conventions. Well, the impact on Hong Kong would be very small. For example, when you try to test that, the administration has been doing that for years, and yet, for the separate water or separate fuel. So basically, only Changi would be able to do that. But then, if everybody will have to go to Changi in order to do that, how much would that cost them? So that's the ramifications of the new requirement. All right. You said that for the use of a new biocide, that would also affect the speed of the vessels. But then, basically, what are the problems that they're likely to encounter? So what additional costs would that add to them? And also, what kind of international challenges will they face? I think that would be more useful to them. Next, I'd like to turn to a more technical point. So it's about GHG's emission. You're talking about vessels over 400 tons. So that's the footnote to para 7. Well, according to what you said, you're talking about merchant shipping. So our fishermen are going to all over the world to fish. So what about Hong Kong ships? Will they also be affected by this new requirement? And of course, for sampans, they're not going to be affected. They're very much local in nature. But what about larger vessels that might go elsewhere? So I won't say no to this because this is an international obligation. But then there are ramifications. It's not just about passage of the law. You will have to make sure that the ramifications are acceptable too. Yes, I fully understand what you said. We need to communicate with the trade. So as I said, the Marine Department already consulted the different committees under its purview. As to their feedback and what they have said, well, we can ask the Marine Department, the Assistant Director, to tell us more. I think this is a very important issue. The Marine Department would consult its advisory committees. That's something that they have to do. But then sometimes these representatives are from different sectors. For example, on the third type vessel from the fishing industry, sometimes the representatives might not be able to attend that particular meeting. So I'm just saying that the consultation might not have been adequate. Okay, thank you for your comment. In fact, on an annual basis, if you remember it, last year we also came here to brief you on the latest amendments. So basically, for every round of new regulations introduced by the IMO, we would not just be consulting the trade, we would also come to this council to consult members. So other than the advisory committees that we consulted in our day-to-day work. We would also have communication and liaison with different trades. So I'll defer to Mr. Liu, who will give you more details. Yes, please supplement briefly. Yes, thank you, Chairman. To respond to the questions and remarks made by Mr. Ho, well, other than consulting the trade in our day-to-day work, we also communicate with the trade on a regular basis. So we will seek their views in our daily work. For example, on the GHG emissions, the Local Vessels Advisory Committee also has a technical committee under its arm. And we would approach them to ask them for their views on the latest requirement. So that's what we have done. Okay. Next, Dr. Wendy Hong. Thank you, Chairman. I support the amendments. But then I have several questions. First, well, there are several environmental protection related issues. You only made the moved the amendments upon the request by the IMO. Do we have our own green port policy? Do you have any specific details that you can share with us? And there is one proposal to prevent vessels from using heavy oil or heavy fuel oil. But then what about vessels using liquefied natural gas? So have we considered introducing those vessels? And also, what about the development of a smart port? What's the progress? Thank you. Yes, Deputy Secretary, thank you for the questions. With regard to the overall GHG emission in Hong Kong, we have to comply with the IMO's requirements. So for vessels, it's of course under the THB and the Marine Department, they will be following up on that. Overall speaking, our Environment Bureau has also announced the 2030 Hong Kong Clean Air 2035 blueprint. So that would also include the checklist or action list so that for vessels, they will have to use clean energy or clean fuel. So for the sulfur content of fuel, that would be tightened up from 0.05% to 0.001%. And also for fuel used on sampans and so on. So for the petrol engine, we will consider issuing new emission standards for these vessels and engines. So that's under the Hong Kong Clean Air 2035. So we'll be making new proposals. And we've been working very hard with the trade on promoting the development of a green port in Hong Kong. So a lot of work has been done. For example, we will use a fuel that would emit less carbon. So we hope to encourage them to convert to LNG fuel. And we've been consulting the trade. We are collecting their views on shipbuilding elsewhere. And then the Marine Department will be issuing guidelines so that they'll be able to do that as soon as possible. So those are the major tasks that we've been doing. Mr. Hong, Ms. Hong also asked about the development of a smart port. Well, this is not directly related to the subject under discussion, but then all I can say is that with regard to the development of a smart port, we've been working with the trade and a task force has been set up with a representative from ship owners and also the relevant groups. We will do analysis and also information collection to find out what other places, including, say, Singapore, have been doing so that we can come up with something that is suitable for Hong Kong so we can develop our own smart port. We have also engaged a third-party group to do this for us. So that's all I'd like to say. Thank you. Okay, we have four more members who would like to speak. because of the time constraint, if there are no other members who would like to speak, I'll draw a line there. Next, Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to ask you this. Yes, because of the IMO and the relevant international conventions, we are having these legislative amendments. And in the paper, it says that some of these will come into effect on the 1st of November 2022. You will have to make sure that you can tie in with the international convention's commencement date, right? So the time is pressing. For example, I noticed that one of these has to do with GHG emission and also the new arrangements on board of vessels. There are new restrictions. These vessels might also need to improve on this GHG emission. They would also have to upgrade the installations on board of the vessel. So given the tight time frame, have you talked to the trade? Have they raised any requests for some support so that they would need some allowances or subsidies in order to ensure that there can be appropriate or alterations or upgrading of a certain equipment and so on in order to comply with the relevant international requirements? I understand that we have to follow these international requirements. I'd just like to know if you've given them any support.
Thank you. Permanent Secretary, thank you, Mr. Chow. In terms of the timetable, I think we mentioned just now that of the five amendments, most of them will come into effect on November 1st this year. For these regulations, normally we will, we'll do it by way of negative vetting. We're now in May. And as soon as possible, we'll amend the relevant regulation and submit them to LegCo. I think we should have enough time to go through the procedure. So we promised Mr. Chow that we'll do so ASAP, and we'll be able to meet the timetable. Secondly, regarding whether we'll provide assistance to the trade, Mr. Liu already said earlier that first of all, during the legislative proposal, we have already consulted the relevant local bodies. Basically, it's the advisory committees under the Marine Department. Besides that, the Marine Department in other venues have also consulted the trade. The Marine Department would liaise with the industry through various venues, and we would also inform them of these developments. And so from time to time, there will be these updates and amendments and we would closely monitor the situation, and if there is a need, we will liaise with the industry and inform them as soon as possible so that they can be well prepared. Mr. Yim Kong, thank you. As a member of the IMO, the latest requirement of the IMO needs to be complied with, and I fully support that. On the other hand, I think we are in a passive position as far as these amendments are concerned. As an international shipping center, I think we should also be able to, I think Hong Kong should be able to initiate our own proposed amendments. I'd like to ask whether or not there have been any amendments which have been initiated by Hong Kong, and if so, do we have any plans to consider, proposing such amendments to the IMO? Permanent Secretary, thank you, Mr. Yim. I think Mr. Yim knows very well that for the marine industry itself in Hong Kong, Mr. Yim is a member of the industry, and I'm grateful for the industry for supporting us all along whenever there have been these amendments to make. The last amendment last technical amendment actually was made in January 2021 when we came to LegCo, and there were a series of proposed amendments which were endorsed last year. They were all technical amendments, for example, amendments relating to the safety valve on vessels and so on. Overall speaking, other than those technical amendments, in terms of promotion of the marine industry, I think for that year we did have many various legislative amendments, mainly concerning, you know, taxation issues. I think what Mr. Yim is asking whether or not Hong Kong has ever initiated any amendments to those maritime regulations to the IMO. And if so, do you have any plans to initiate any such or propose any such amendments, to the IMO? Well, I was just saying that we have many such legislative amendments, but for Hong Kong to proactively, propose or initiate such amendment, that have been relatively few. Well, China is a signatory to the IMO, and whenever the IMO meet, we would attend such meetings. Of course, we have a lot of liaison with the IMO, but even globally speaking, there are very few occasions where a jurisdiction will proactively initiate or propose such amendments to the IMO. Mr. Lam Siu Long. I think Mr. Lam and Mr. Chow has already asked the question I wanted to put. The last member to ask question, Mr. Chen Siu Hong. Regarding the proposed amendments, I understand the need for these amendments, but we need to build Hong Kong as an international shipping center, and we need to enact legislation so that we can comply with the latest requirement of the IMO, and I support that, especially as it involves, you know, anti-pollution and environmental protection. I'm all in agreement with that because we need to aim for sustainable development and carbon neutrality. But according to the paper, as the chairman said, all these proposals are rather technical. Many of us present here do not really fully understand these technical details. This is the Economic Development Panel. Since the Bureau has conducted so much consultation and studies, I think after consulting the stakeholders, I wonder whether or not in your paper you can give us more details. For example, with all these regulations would need to be amended, how would that impact on the Hong Kong economy? What measures can be taken after you've consulted industry so that the government can help the industry? Or if you want to develop Hong Kong into an international shipping center, will these new amendments bring opportunities? For example, can the GBA can become a certification center so that we can build Hong Kong into a carbon trading center for the shipping industry? Of course, as the Economic Development Panel, I don't think we should focus on the technical details. I think we should be more concerned about the future development of Hong Kong as a shipping center. And also in the GBA area, with these amendments, will they also, bring opportunities for Hong Kong? So I think we should look at it from that perspective rather than just talking about the need for legislative amendment and negative vetting and so on. So does the administration have such a plan, other than the technical amendments? Is there any room for discussion regarding how this will impact on our economic development? I'd like to make an observation here. The Economic Development Panel has our own terms of reference, and the administration doesn't have any choice whenever they need to amend the relevant legislation, they have to come to this panel for approval before they can submit it to the council for negative vetting. So it's not the fault of the administration. Secondly, as to whether the administration will incorporate the views of the industry, say 76% are in favor, 36% against, and so on, whether they need to let members know, or like Mr. Holden Chow said, whether because of this amendment, some of the, you know, bodies who have been consulted may need some assistance, and whether or not we can, you know, we should develop ourselves as Hong Kong as a certification center. Thank you, Chairman, for your supplement. I fully agree with the Chairman that, first of all, the legislative proposals, for these legislative proposals, we need to come and consult this panel. During the last term, many members have also gave us valuable views. We're very happy to come here to listen to the views of members. And secondly, regarding the progress of our work, every year we would, the Policy Bureau, through the policy address or in terms of transportation and logistics industry, they will also be covered in the policy address. And where members ask us many questions, whether it's questions from LegCo or the Special Finance Committee meetings, we have explained to members how we plan to develop our port. And on those occasions, we explain our policies to members, and if members have any views, further views, we will be more than happy to come again to explain to members. Well, our discussion on this item will end here. May I ask whether there are any members who would object to putting this proposal to the council? So if not, then the proposals are approved. Thank you very much. Last item on the agenda is AOB. Do we have any other business? If not, I now declare that we are adjourned. Thank you.